This episode of the PC Perspective Podcast is brought to you by Audible.com. For a free 30-day trial, go to audible.com/PCper. And by Braintree Payments. Mobile app development can be complex, but integrating your payments no longer has to be. With Braintree, your business can accept nearly every type of payment from any device with just one integration. Learn more at braintreepayments.com/PCper. Hey everybody, welcome to the PC Perspective Podcast. This is episode 387, being recorded on February, 17th, 2016. I'm Ryan Shrout.
I'm Jeremy Hellstrom.
I'm professional Josh Walrath.
And I'm unprofessional Alan Momentan.
Even when we record the intro twice, I still have to check the date.
Yes.
So today is still the 17th. For some reason, I kept going like 13th or 20th. Like those are the only two options it could be.
But toggle.
Those are Saturdays, unrelated to the Wednesdays. Something to do with I'm leaving on the 20th, so the 20th
you're already
keeps sticking in my mind. Yeah, I'm reverse jet lagged. I'm preparing to go out of town. Welcome to the show, everybody. Speaking of going out of town, so I'm leaving on Saturday. I won't be here for next week's show. You guys are going to have to do it without me.
Oh, okay.
You're going to be too busy being either. Pickpocketed in Barcelona.
That's right. Because I don't think it's realistically possible for me to do the show since I will be 5 hours ahead of this time.
Sure, it's realistic.
So I'm not going to be up at 3 a.m.
I mean, take one for the team.
Before to do
you
the
might
show.
Be, depending on
well,
if you're still...
if something happens,
if you're still screwed
be,
up on the time zones.
Yeah. If I'm screwed up by that point, I will stay screwed up because I'm coming on Thursday.
Or you'll be laid out in an alley.
Like murdered? Like...
Or unconscious or something.
Oh, you know, no.
It's Barcelona.
Well, I don't know. I've never been there.
He's going to be getting a private dance with one of those girls that plays the clapper things.
Oh, with like little cymbals on her hand. Yeah.
Not Morocco.
The spoons.
Not Morocco.
You mean the spoons, right?
Yeah. The clappers, if you know what
the
I'm
clappers.
Saying.
Clappers.
You'll be spooning with the clap.
Don't get the clap.
Also, I thought this was funny. I'd point this out. I got one of those calls yesterday from... Microsoft support about my computer sending out a negative data or bad information.
Negative
on the
energy,
internet, right? Yeah, bad energy waves, right?
You got to replace the crystals in
and
your
they were
case.
Gonna they were gonna help me fix it. Like they were Microsoft tech support, and they were gonna help me fix it. And I had to go to this website. It was nobody go to this, obviously, but I was like, oh yeah, oh yeah, no. He's
oh,
like,
you're playing.
Oh
a lot.
Yeah, I was like, he's like, are you in front of your computer? I'm like, yeah. And he's like, I loved the direction they had to take because they're so used to getting a hold of idiots or just people who don't know anything about their computer. That's who they're trying to get, right?
Yeah.
And he's like, on your keyboard, you should see the far bottom left corner says control.
Cause
and I'm like,
those,
yeah. And he's like, what is the button immediately next to that? I'm like, it's the Windows button. He's like, okay. Good. Now he knows if you're on a Windows or a Mac. And now he knows which direction he can go, if anything.
Okay.
And he's like, I want you to hold down that button with one finger and then hit R with another finger.
Oh, he wants you to run something.
And yeah, and you go to, and he goes, what shows up? It's like, it's a run dialogue. And you can hear he kind of pauses. He's like,
oh.
Because anybody smart enough to just be catching this would have been gone long ago.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. And he had me type in, he said he wanted me to type in this thing, right? Uh-huh. And it was a web address. But he didn't. It was fastheal.net, right? That's what it was. That's what it turns out to be.
I'm not.
But
going
every let don't ever go to that website. I didn't go to it either. I looked up screenshots of it on Google as he was telling me what it was.
Oh, okay.
But he was like, "I want you to type F as in Frank, A as in aardvark." Like
aardvark.
It was everything.
Wow.
I don't know what it was.
But
don't go
A
phonetic. Just
as
go
in Mancy.
Yeah.
Like everything was laid out, and
you
then
went with the zoo letters,
you go to the web page. I didn't go to it. I looked at screenshots with it, but it's like this. Stupid looking like 1987 looking website, and it's like on the right hand corner it's like there's three buttons and it's connect to technician one, connect to technician two, connect to technician three.
What was the website?
You get to choose fastheal.net. and it's like
you get to
I want
choose.
You to go ahead is it taken down now?
No.
That's
fastheal.net.
That's awesome.
That's not, I don't think that's what it was.
Is
there just a say connect to technician anywhere on that? Because he was like, I want you to click on connect to technician three. That's me.
Yeah.
And
I want to talk to technician.
The hyperlink is fastseal.net/soft3.exe.
Yeah. So he was like, so when you click that, what happens? And I said, I don't think I'm going to click that. And he was like, why? It's like, because I'm pretty sure you're just scamming me, right? Because I tried three times. I was like, what company are you with? Right? He's like, oh, you know, Microsoft, something. I was like, yeah, I know, but you're a contractor, right? Like, where are you at? Like, where are you from? And he couldn't get anything. I was like, yeah, no, I'm pretty sure you're just scamming me,
I'm
right?
I'm from Josh
like,
Tech.
No. Click. It's like, oh, well. It's really frustrating to me that exists.
Yeah.
And that, like, somehow not wherever government they're at is not.
You really freak them out if you, like, make up, like, a three-letter agency and you, like, say, all right, so stay on the phone longer. We're going to, hey, can you trace this call? Start the trace. Okay, yeah. You were saying?
The email is ryam at nsa.gov.
I had never actually got one of those. I'd heard about them, but I was already annoyed because my daughter was asleep and they rang the home phone line, which nobody ever calls unless they're selling me something, which I just need to disconnect it and be done. I don't know. So welcome to the show, everybody. We do record live on Wednesday nights, 7 p.m. Pacific, 10 p.m. Eastern at pcpro.com/live. If you need a reminder, we have a mailing list you can sign up for at pcpro.com/subscribe. If you go to that URL, you can get this little page here, which will ask for your name and your email address, and it will simply, we send out an email a couple of hours, an hour before we do a live stream.
If you choose Technician 3, it's Josh.
Right. Yes. Yeah, we send an email to fastheal.net. Please choose Technician Josh.
And he will call you.
Wait, that's what turned Josh Tech into. Yes. It's like a duplicate of one of those websites.
Yeah, just ripped the source out.
Yeah. Only REXE file will just be like a dancing Josh. Right.
Dancing
Josh.
Dancing.
Dance for me.
Dancing. So I'm going to outlive y'all.
Oh, man.
Oh, in stereo.
So,
nope, still mono.
That's that. We are going to have, so we've got the podcast tonight. I do Twitch tomorrow.
Yep.
And then Friday, it's on the schedule, so I guess I'll mention it. We have Friday at 3 p.m. Eastern, noon Pacific, scheduled Ryan 3D Prints Part 1.
Oh.
Ryan 3D Prints Part 1.
We're going to stream that live?
We're going to stream it live, and then obviously...
What could possibly go wrong?
All kinds of things. So, I've
been looking forward to this for a long time.
This was an idea that Ken had when we found out Monoprice was going to do 3D printers.
Ken's idea. Let's make fun of Ryan on the stream somehow.
Yeah.
No, it's genuine.
Basically what happens is we went to Monoprice and said, hey, we want to do this thing where you send us 3D printers, starting out with the most basic one, moving up to the medium, moving up to the higher end.
Okay.
Right? And you give us filament or whatever. And I know absolutely zero about 3D printing. I don't know anything about it. I didn't know what PLA, ABS, and PET were, you know, what the differences were. None of that. I didn't know about multi-extruder. Mm-hmm. I didn't know about the heated plates. I don't know anything about that, right? And I still barely know anything. And the idea is I'm going to buy this, or they're going to send me this $199 3D printer like any normal consumer would that knows nothing about this.
Sure.
And I'm going to put the box on the table, and I'm going to open it up, and I'm going to try to set it up, and I'm going to try to print something. And then we're going to do multiple parts where it's like, okay, now that I know that I can print this cube, what else can I make? What else can we do? Let's try different types of filament. Let's try the glow in the dark. Let's try the cleaning stuff. You know, they're going to send us some, you know, how do I download plans? They'll print out little stupid little gadgets and neat things and trinkets and things. And then we'll move on to the higher end stuff. You know, they want to send us one of their drones that we can then break and then 3D print replacement parts for.
Really?
Yeah.
They give you the plans? Fun.
Yeah, they have all the 3D schematics for all the replacement parts for their drones.
Saw the other day that Thermaltake has a website with parts they designed for the P5 case, mounted case we have over here.
So you can 3D print out, you know, optical drive bays for it because it didn't come with optical drive bays, right? I think that was one of them.
Yeah, we can 3D print a Fury X plate.
Right, yeah.
Nut covers.
Pretty awesome.
Nut covers.
We can print our own nook.
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 Nook. Nook.
So yeah, that's the idea. So we'll do one of these on Friday, and then I'll be gone for the week. So we'll have to wait until the week after, probably to do another one and figure out what we're going to do. And I think that'll be a fun thing to interact with, take suggestions from the audience on what to print. And, you know, the printing process will take a long time when it's live. Obviously, for the YouTube versions, we will compress that. But
no, just leave it going.
Oh, no, we're going to. I'm just going to leave the stream on. So if people just want to watch it print, like, I think some people will be interested.
We'll be back tomorrow, like just overnight.
I think some people will be interested in that. Like, I want to watch.
Our stream won't stay up that long.
Watch. Well, I'll get this other setup going first. Yeah. So anyway, that's another stream we have coming up this week. So sign up for the mailing list. Also, we have our Patreon at patreon.com/PCPer if you're interested in these types of things and the capabilities we have to do other stuff like the 3D Ryan 3D Prints Extravaganza Part 1. We are still not at our $2,000 a month goal. We definitely want to hit that before the end of this month. And I really, really, really want to get to that next milestone that was going to allow us to do our mailbag stuff. I want to do the mailbag. It's something that I know a lot of people have asked for. So we want to hit that next milestone after the 2,000 month. So if you like the content, if you appreciate it, if you think we're worth it, even if you don't think all of us are worth it, do you know what I'm saying? I'm not bringing anybody up in particular. Go to patreon.com/PCPer. Offer up what you can. We greatly, greatly appreciate any support from our fans, viewers, and readers, which I think should cover all avenues, and listeners as well, all avenues of our media distribution models.
Your empire.
Yes, exactly. And the last couple of things before we get into the actual stories of the week, don't forget on March 5th, Saturday, March 5th, we have our Fragging Frogs virtual LAN party number 12. That's at 10, starts at 10 a.m. on March 5th. You can go to pcpro.com, look for that post. Jeremy, if you think about it, let's make that post like back up to the top, reset the timing on it.
I meant to do that today, but I forgot.
No problem. And then on March 6th, we'll have another stupid, crazy live stream where we're going to stream for 12 hours, hopefully consecutively.
Someone just told me that YouTube only lets you stream for 8 hours.
YouTube only lets you stream for 8 hours?
We'll have to look into that.
We'll have to see. It may be a Twitch-only stream then. I don't know what to say. But March 6th, so on Sunday, we'll do a 12-hour stream from noon to midnight where we'll probably do some 3D printing, set one up and have it, you know, keep going and check in with it every once in a while. Yeah. Alan's going to teach us how to solder. We'll do some gaming. We'll do some Q&A. We'll have some guests on. Just kind of a potpourri of content, if you will.
It's not going to smell good in here after 12 hours.
Well, it'll smell like pizza and BO. Wait, Sebastian's coming. So he smells pretty good.
He's going to just counter it.
He's a vegetarian, so like he just...
So he's going to smell like hummus?
He eats a lot of beans.
I don't get it.
So don't order meat on your pizza?
Oh, no. Extra sausage on all the pizza. Off. Yeah, exactly.
Make them all sausage.
Right.
Oh, you want to eat?
Sebastian's just in the corner picking sausage off a pizza.
All right, let's get to the stuff. ASUS PB328Q review. This is an interesting monitor. It's different than a lot of displays we've looked at recently in that it does not have a gaming focus to it. It's a 32-inch...
Oh, yeah, that one.
It's a 32-inch 2560 by 1440, which is already kind of unique. All right, there are several other on the market, but to me, this was a unique combination of resolution and size.
Yep.
We're used to 27-inch monitors at this resolution. This is significantly larger than that. It's a VA panel, right? So it is
not MVA, right?
I don't know. I know it's not
VA.
VA, which is the IPS-like technology that is not VA in any capacity.
Right, right, right.
I don't know if it's NVA. All they listed as is a VA display.
Well, so PVA and MVA were very, very similar. So
okay,
probably just an offshoot.
All right. So if VA technology kind of sits between TN and IPS in terms of characteristics of image quality and response time and all that type of stuff. VA generally produces good blacks, pretty good color reproduction. Mm-hmm. Decent viewing angles, but not as good as IPS.
Right.
But at the expense of pixel response time in most cases. And that's generally what we came up with this display. So you can see like the ID, the design of this is very similar to anything we've seen from ASUS recently. It's not an ROG Swift. It's like I said, it's from a different line. It's not their gaming series of displays. It has the same, you can see this shot. It's got a very thin bezel to it. Pretty nice. Because it's a VA screen, you can turn it, put it in portrait mode, no issues there. The back is fairly plain. You've got your USB hub. You've got full VESA mount if you want to do that. The controls and OSD and all that stuff are as good as we've seen on ASUS displays recently. It has a DVI connection, DisplayPort, HDMI. That's HDMI 1.4. And then VGA. Because, you know.
Yeah.
Do what you got to do. And there's your USB input and your audio pass through. Everything else seems pretty good on this. Overdrive, not great. Wasn't awful, but it's not great. It's not like up to the caliber of many, many, many other gaming monitors that we have seen recently. So if you go to the review and you go down to this page here where we look at the overdriving testing screenshots, you'll see ASUS calls overdrive trace-free. And even at its maximum setting, we still had a fairly visible trailing blade. Yeah. I keep wanting to say fin.
Ghost.
Yeah, well, a visible blade of the windmill behind it, ghosted image of it.
Yeah, it didn't fade completely. It's not
inverse like in some of the other.
Well, right. inverse is when you're overdriving too far.
Yeah.
Like when your setting is too, you know.
Which is what we've seen in previous ASUS monitors when you set it to 100. Yeah, when you set trace through to 100, it's because it's overdriving too much.
Yep.
And we, on this monitor, we're never able to overdrive too much. And in fact, we're never really overdrive
enough.
Good enough, yeah. I think, to really make it what it was. Calibration-wise, color reproduction, it's awesome. After calibration, it looks amazing, right? I was going to say stupendous, but I think that's a dumb word. Looks well, looks great. We have the profile for you to download if you want to apply. Viewing angles are okay. You know, the straight-on viewing angle is fantastic. The other ones are pretty good. You still see some of the off-angle... Without what would you call this? It's where you can see the red, but you don't get any of the color shift in the viewing angle test.
I mean, it shifts slightly. It's more like the contrast was shifting more instead of the color.
Than the color. Okay.
Yeah.
So it was good.
Which gives you red letters in that particular test when the contrast changes.
It's good, but it wasn't fantastic.
It wasn't IPS good.
No, not in that regard.
But it was way better than TN.
But one of the, I mean, so all that kind of aside, this is a $539 monitor, right? So it's a 32-inch screen, so it's a sizable screen. It's 2560 by 1440, 539, no variable refresh. Oh, this does have a 75 hertz refresh, I should point out, right? So
yep.
It's better than 60, you know, noticeably better than 60 in Windows, right, when you're moving things around. But It's a decent monitor. It's actually, I think, a good monitor for
productivity,
content creation,
yeah,
those types of things. For gaming, it's kind of like it would be fine. Like if your primary function for this display is to do Photoshop and Premiere, and your secondary function is you want to play some games,
yeah,
fine. If your primary function is games, there's way too many good gaming monitors out there to recommend this one over that. Unless you're one of those people that's just like, hey, I love the idea of a 32-inch 25 by 14 display.
It is noticeably bigger.
Yeah.
Like 27 to 32, it's actually like, you know, you kind of, in your mind, you might just jump to like, well, they're both kind of 30. No, it's right. Like 5 inches bigger.
Yeah, 27 to 32 is a sizable jump.
Yeah.
Right? Even though, yes, you could round down or up or whatever you want to do.
Yeah.
It's still pretty a big difference. I would agree on that point. So check it out. Check out the review for more thoughts on it. There's competitors from Samsung and Acer that are probably using the same VA panel.
Yep.
But it's a good point of comparison to have for this monitor review and others really going forward. Up next, let's talk, Alan, you posted a review of the Samsung 750 Evo, product that I had no idea was coming out, a product that...
There was a leak like a few months back because they were shipping them in Asia and overseas and stuff.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
So what's a 750 Evo?
Okay, so remember the 840 Evo?
I do.
Oh, no.
Well, okay. Without that slowdown over time issue, because they fixed that.
Okay.
And also with slightly revised 2D flash, so the flat stuff, right? Not their V-NAND.
The flat stuff. Okay. Yeah. Sure.
So the idea is Samsung wants to move their V-NAND from 32-layer to 48-layer,
mm-hmm.
and they want to make higher capacity dies, mm-hmm. right? So that's coming. And you, as you can imagine, they don't want to have to keep making 32-layer stuff. And if you're trying to make small capacity SSDs, you need more dies.
Right.
Like, you need smaller capacity dies so you can have more of them and keep your parallelism high and keep your performance good overall, right? Because once you get up, once you get all the way up to like, 32 gigabytes per die capacity, you're trying to make 128 gig SSD, like it's four dies on the SSD, so it's not very parallel, right? And flash memory, each individual die takes X amount of time to do a particular operation.
Right.
So you need more of them, right?
Sure.
When I talked to them back at their Samsung, like in Seoul, when they did the 950 Pro launch, I talked to one of their VPs, and he was like, well, we're probably going to do this, we'll probably make these 48-layer VNAND in dies that are also half the capacity. I think instead they opted to do this, which is to just have a further shrink of their planar NAND, because that would be a separate production line for them. And they're just, it's a die shrink. It's not really, the endurance seems the same. The performance of those dies seems the same. It's just that it's a little bit smaller, so it'll be a little bit cheaper to make.
Okay.
Right? So you could fit more on a wafer, right?
Yeah.
So they're taking the planar stuff and they're putting it into two small capacity SSDs. So imagine just 840 Evo style devices, but only available in 120 and 250 gig. And the
they're only not 120 and 250.
Yep. Okay. And they're not going to make a 120 any more of the 850 Evo when that moves to 48 layer VNAND.
Okay.
Because they're going to shift that line over.
Would that be one half of one chip?
No, it would just be like, it would just be so few of them, right? It would just basically be. That would only be four dies.
This is crazy to me. So this is a picture of the inside of the 750 Evo.
Look at all that wasted space. There's so much space for activities.
So we kind of saw this with the 850 Evos when we looked at them. Like the smallest capacity was kind of this thing. Right. But now it's like you have two capacities that are...
they've got twice the room.
Like the entire product range has PCBs that short, so it's kind of funny that like the 2.5-inch form factor is how the you can't change it, but
They might come out with this in mSATA. I would imagine it wouldn't be hard because we know they could fit the stuff on the PCB.
Why not make a 2 terabyte version of this with your cheapest dies? Like you've got plenty of room for more chips in there. Would it be that much? Do you think they could make it less expensive? Could we get to 10 cents per gig?
I don't know.
Well, probably not 10.
Maybe just not 10, saying. But, I don't know.
It's not really a matter of space with these
products. Yeah, I guess not. I mean, I just hate to see all that wasted space. Like, remember back in the days when OCZ made its 3.5-inch SSD because they needed the space to fit that much memory in it.
Yeah. And now there's room.
Now we've got plenty of space.
I think they're just leaving the premium capacities, like the large capacities, to the 850 Evo territory.
Right.
No, it's an SSD with a secret hiding place in it.
Because
the stash. You could put like.
Because I mean, those
stash of cash. In there.
I mean, the 850 Evos are kind of going.
Don't steal my SSD.
850 Evos are kind of going for like around
SSD
about 30 cents a gig.
SSD is smoking now.
Right.
Right. They're going for around 30 cents a gig. This the 250 gig launches at 30 cents a gig MSRP.
Right.
So hopefully sales will be even lower than that.
Even more impressive, I think, than the 30 cents per gig is just like saying, did you get a 250 gig SSD for $75?
Yes.
Right. See, that sounds more impressive to me than 30 cents per gig.
That's the thing. It used to be that the 30 cents a gig you only get in the much larger capacities. The idea here is they're able to hit that price point even at like a relatively small capacity.
Right.
What did you say the 120 goes for?
The 120 is only $20 cheaper.
Like what's
55 bucks?
Okay. 46.
Yeah, it's like 46.
I mean, that's undercutting the 850 Evo right now. Even in like in the channel of sales, it's $67 on Amazon right now. For 120.
So they're going for like but you're only shaving just like a few bucks when you're at such a small capacity and 30 cents a gig ish, pricing. I do like the idea of if you're kind of like a power user, but on the cheap. In a desktop system, and you're the kind of person that was rating a couple of SSDs back in the day. Like you could do it again with this 30 cents a gig. You can have 500 gig worth of, Evo style, like with SLC cache.
When are they supposed to be available?
Pretty soon, actually. They're not. I didn't see them for sale yet.
No, that's what I was just doing.
But I think it's just a matter of like just getting them in stock and stuff like that in places. So
keep in mind that you have the screenshot on the last page. The 850 Evo launched 250 gigs at $189.
Yeah.
And we are now at $75 for the same capacity and a little bit better performance.
It is a little bit better. It's a little bit slower than 120 gig 850 Evo because it doesn't have VNAND working for it and that sort of stuff, right? So I did some latency percentile stuff.
What page I look here? The second to last page?
Second to the last page.
Okay.
I was working on this new workload that was supposed to like show a difference between cached and uncached stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So you apply a workload to the SSD, and if you do it continuously for 100 seconds, it'll probably run into the TLC cache. That's the idea, right? And if you do it intermittently, then chances are it will not run into the TLC cache. You're giving the drive a chance to empty that SLC out to the TLC, you know, in those gaps of time, right? Mm-hmm. To be more of a consumer kind of test. And I also was working at a consumer queue depth. So it's going more like queue depth of 4, like something that you would typically see for writes, like random write queue depth 4. That'd probably be like the most demanding thing a just average user might do to the drive. So the intermittent workload and the continuous workload on both capacities. And neither of them ran into the cache, like ran out of cache and ran into the TLC space because it wasn't seeing enough IOPS. Like it was actually able to keep up even continuously.
Oh, I see.
Because the cache on this, you know, it's like everything that gets written to it goes into the cache first. And then in the background, the dies are trying to shift over from SLC to TLC.
Mm-hmm.
And they can do that whenever they're idle. And so in the grand scheme of things, at a queue depth of 4, it wasn't able to tax this enough to make it, you know, run out of enough idle time, even continuous 4K random. So that resulted in an extremely tight band between the four. And if you look at the percentile, so the top one there is all four different SSDs doing intermittent or continuous workloads at queue depth of 4 random writes.
Mm.
And they're all basically identical. And then to show something where they weren't identical anymore, I added a couple of OCC try-ons.
Mm-hmm.
The 100 and the 150, which we have a review coming up on, but we're still trying to get them to work some bugs out, as you can see by that graph there. The Tryon 100, it is the same workload, just done for 100 seconds continuously, and you can kind of tell where those drives run out of speed. First, you can tell what their SLC speed is. It's like the where that bottom section is, where the two drives are close together,
mm-hmm.
like that bottom maybe quarter or so. But then they start to separate. So one of those drives runs out of cache and shifts over to TLC, and that's what that second like kind of arcs over to that slower speed. And the newer version of the Tryon actually hangs in there for longer, but then once it does run out, it's writing even slower than the previous version of the Tryon. But if you look at that, all of that stuff falls well later or longer latency than anything that these drives are doing, than these 750 Evos are doing. So when it comes to like, you know, keeping your system feeling snappy and stuff like that, it looks like if you want to do a budget thing, as far as this testing has shown so far.
256 gig drive for $75. Like I said, taking the cost per gig out of it just sounds awesome.
Just $75, like for good performing
stuff. $75 for basically a little bit more than the price of one PC game.
Just buy one.
You can just buy one and add it to your system. You should just buy one.
That should be the tagline. Just buy one.
Well, it's like this is just like a default.
Which would be for sale.
Like, you know, yeah, they just need to be for sale. But like, if, you know, this is like you're building a computer for your neighbor, like anything like that.
Just buy one.
You know, this is the SSD you throw in it. Like, it's just that cheap.
Like, you get this and you spend $100 on a 2 terabyte hard drive.
Yeah. I just like that you, with that price point, assuming the MSRP actually sticks and people don't like overprice it at all, but like, that's not even a sale, right? The other drives, you have to kind of wait. You know, like, I've had family members wanting to buy, you know, an SSD, and I'm just like, well, this one's good, but wait for a sale.
Right.
Like with this one, you don't even say the wait for a sale part. You're just like,
I'm waiting
for the
sale down to 10 cents per gig, though.
They're going to like
$12 SSD.
Yeah,
it'll be
$25.
$24.99. That's all I want.
Wow. That'd be a heck of a sale.
When you put it that way, it sounds ridiculous.
A couple of McDonald's value meals in San Francisco.
See, that's the thing. Yeah, see, that's why I think 10 cents a gig is going to take a little while.
Whatever. Would you have thought we would have had a $55 120 gig drive? Or $75.
Just think how many OS drives you could have.
That's the other thing. I have a hard.
No, that's actually a good point.
That's the other thing. I have a hard time recommending the 120 gig at all.
Yeah, no, I wouldn't.
It's $20 difference.
Yeah.
Right. It's like you're already spending $55.
I agree.
Just $20 more. You more than double the capacity.
Right.
Like, So why, you know, constrain yourself to 120 gig, which you'll probably run out of. 250, you're less likely to run out of.
Yeah.
You know. Yeah. So
that's cool. I mean, so that's a 750 Evo from Samsung. Just, you know, the naming is maybe a little bit odd.
Yeah, it is weird. I think they wanted to more distinguish it away from the 800 series. So they were just like, look, it's
30.
They could have done, but now they have like 950, 850.
Yeah,
it's too late. Yeah. So I think they're just trying to keep them all something 50.
It's fine. I don't really have that big of a problem with it.
Yeah.
All right, let's talk about Vulkan. We've been talking about it for a while. Mantle became Vulkan, kind of. There was some controversy over that. Yesterday, Vulkan was kind of officially released. It's a 1.0 release. It's out in the world now. It's a hard launch. You can go download it. You can develop for it. It's an API.
It's yet another Vulkan API.
Okay.
Yes, whatever Josh said. It's a Vulkan API.
Vulkan.
So Scott wrote this up. He gave me a couple of notes here, right? That they did a hard launch of the API. It's not just a spec or a driver. It's several SDKs, examples, tools, samples, a patch for the Talos Principle, which is another puzzle game.
Okay.
That I think, Josh, you were talking about last week or the week before as well. That actually has a patch now that enables a Vulkan API run through. Actually, it has DX11. No. 9. 11. 11. OpenGL and Vulkan. You can select from those APIs in the game now. So they're making it a cornerstone for that.
Those Crow Team guys, they kind of like to push things.
They do. And I've talked with them and worked with them on a couple of other projects, and they definitely do. They were on board on the whole like frame pacing, frame timing thing from the get-go with us as well. Scott says, you know, they just basically did what they needed to. DirectX 12 doesn't have any market share outside of pre-release games. So, you know, Vulkan's kind of like they're trying to get into early market share leads here. The major question going forward is whether or not engines and middleware will actually take up Vulkan instead of DX12, and if performance will be equivalent or better. I tried to run some benchmarks on the Talos Principle. I haven't had a chance to do it yet. I saw computerbase.de or something do some. And the general consensus is with the current drivers and the current setup, like the Vulkan path is slower than the DX11 path by a fairly significant margin. But if you care about vendor-to-vendor comparisons, the Fury X was faster than the 980 Ti at 2560 and 1080p.
Okay.
Right. So in theory, you could posit that, well, okay, two things. One, Vulkan is not as optimized as DirectX 11. Not a surprise.
Sure.
And also that AMD might be better at Vulkan than NVIDIA is, which would also not be a surprise being the Mantle heritage that it has. But I don't expect NVIDIA to work on it in the same way that they've worked on OpenGL. Right, NVIDIA kind of was unmatched in OpenGL performance for a long, 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 long time.
Yeah,
and so we'll see if they put that same kind of effort into that. There wasn't a whole lot of new information in the announcement, Scott says, although the SDK material, such as the quick reference guide, had a few insights in it. Various supported device types, including CPU, discrete, integrated, virtual, or other. So he didn't notice what virtual or other was. My guess is virtual is like VM-based units, like maybe or something like that. I don't know. Virtual likely means Vulkan supported in VM. You know, see, there you go. Other, not sure.
Other is my favorite graphics adapter type.
Maybe special compute accelerators like FPGAs that could be loaded by Vulkan. Unclear.
Snapdragon.
At this point. Yeah. Well, was it ARM? Maybe it's ARM. No, Intel, NVIDIA, and who was the third company that had conformant driver, Imagination Tech.
Yeah, it was Imagination.
Yeah. Yeah, but I mean, like, the Android guys are all going to support Vulkan. Linux guys are all going to support Vulkan. So expect, you know, that whole thing to pan out. I just, you know, everybody has kind of, a lot of people have pledged that, hey, yes, we're going to work in Vulkan, but nobody has really said we're going to, like, dedicate a bunch to it. Like, if you look at this slide from the ecosystem presentation from Vulkan, you know, they list Oxide and Blizzard and EA and Epic and Valve and Unity. Yes, they'll have support for it, but how much so and how much, you know, effort do they put into those versus maybe DX12,
right?
Which is going to have the kind of default user base. of Windows 10.
I mean, that's obviously going to get all the attention first, like, so.
I think so. I think so, it will. All right, we're going to take a quick break here, guys, and thank a returning podcast sponsor, not a new one. That would be our friends at audible.com, supporting the PC Perspective podcast. They are a leading provider of audiobooks. If you don't know who Audible is, probably never listened to the internet before, right?
Anything.
Like, anything on the internet, or just the internet in general. They have 180,000 downloadable titles, it says here, across all types of literature, fiction, nonfiction, and periodicals. I've never read a magazine in audiobook form.
I don't know how that would go.
Maybe they mean more like professional type.
Like just the articles.
Are the ads read louder in a different voice?
I read it for the articles. I listen to it for the articles.
Ken listens to it for the articles.
It's Playboy and Audible. So you got this gal here. She's a badass.
If you get the right narrator, that could be.
I never thought it would happen to me, but.
One disservice I think that we have to this stuff is that it's called audiobooks still, because books, but it's like well, if it can be periodicals, part, if it can be, you know, all types of things. But to me, and they mentioned this here, it's like the benefit of what an audiobook is not that you're getting different content. It's how you can consume it. Right. Yeah. So if you're the type of person that, you know, I did this all the time in the summer when you're like doing yard work. Mowing the lawn, weed eating, doing landscaping, all that kind of stuff. If you're spending 3 hours outside, you've got 3 hours where you can have your mind doing something as well. If you have a long commute or even a short commute, if you ride the bus, you know, take the train, have a longer drive. If you're going to the gym to work out, or you're doing running, cleaning house, that's something I would do all the time. I would listen to podcasts and audiobooks when cleaning the house for a couple of hours, right?
Yeah.
Had a Sonos system so you could blare it across everything in all the rooms. Didn't matter where you walked. It was actually pretty nice. For our audience members, Audible is offering a 30-day trial. If you go to audible.com/PCPer and browse the over 180,000 audio programs, you can download a title for free and start listening to it. It's really just that easy.
You can get 11/22/63 and listen to it before you watch the series on Hulu.
Is it on Audible?
Yeah.
Yeah?
Yeah. That's okay. where I quote-unquote read that book.
I know. We always have this discussion when we have an Audible podcast. Is it reading or is it listening?
Yeah.
I still think reading is the right.
I just listened to it like to and from work back in San Antonio over the course of like a couple of weeks or so, like, because it was a long one.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because it was unabridged. It was like the whole book, you know. Yeah.
Josh, I know Josh and Jeremy both. I asked you guys for suggestions for this. What options did you come up with?
You know, it's kind of a funny thing. Jeremy and I did separate ones before, you know, looked them up. And I chose a Larry Correa novel, and he chose a John Scalzi novel. So if you followed the Hugo Award things, you know that these guys are not entirely friendly to each other. It's kind of funny, actually.
What was the title of yours, Josh?
Mine's Monster Hunter International. It's a really kind of fun book, fast-paced. Lots of action. It's, you know, literary value is questionable, but it's enjoyable.
I mean, literary value is in the eye of the beholder, right?
Yeah, yeah. But, you know, when I picked this up and read it regularly, I just whizzed right through it. It was a very fast, fun, enjoyable read. And I imagine I've heard good things about the people who have produced the recordings of his book. So this sounds like it's a lot of fun.
Nice. There it is. Monster Hunter International. Free with your 30-day trial and membership. If you go to audible.com/PCPer, you can pick that one up. Jeremy, what was your suggestion?
Oh, I went with Lock-In by John Scalzi, which is more of a near future, not quite a dystopian, but there's been a disease which has sort of changed the face of the world significantly. And it's read by Will Wheaton, so I mean, how can you get enough of Will Wheaton?
He's actually pretty good at reading those.
Is he? Yeah, he is.
Yeah.
He's pretty good at reading.
Well, that too. But, like, you know.
It takes a special kind of talent to do an audiobook.
Yeah, like he has a good voice for it. Like, it's, you know.
I will say one of the things that shows up here with this Monster Hunter International, at least, is that it is Whisper Sync for Voice Ready, which is the ability to, if you have a Kindle, you can read it.
Or even the Kindle app on a PC, I think. It also flies.
Or your phone or whatever.
Yeah.
And then where you stop reading it, if you start playing back the audio version, it c- kicks up where you left off in the reading. And then if you go back to the book version of it or the digital book version of it, it kind of goes back and forth on it as well, which is a really cool feature. So you guys can check that out, audible.com/PCPer. You get 30 days for free. And we thank Audible for their support of the PC Perspective podcast. And now on to your normally scheduled programming as he rotates through the tabs on his thing. So let's talk about a DisplayPort adapter, because that's riveting entertainment.
Yeah. Right?
Ken wrote this up. We got in an Accell DisplayPort 1.2 to HDMI 2.0 active adapter. It is this beautiful piece of technology that you see here before you.
It's got shiny piano black.
It's plastic. Shiny and very piano black.
A little black dongle.
And what's significant of this is that AMD really needed these things to come out months ago, right, and really be available. I know somebody in the comments pointed out that, like, Club 3D had one.
But it hasn't been that long.
It hasn't been that long, and also, like, every time I've ever looked at it, it's not been in stock. And I think that's only in Europe. Aren't they only a European reseller?
I don't think so.
I don't know. This is basically allow you to convert a DisplayPort 1.2 port to HDMI 2.0, keeping in mind that the Fury X, the Fury, and the R9 Nano did not have HDMI 2.0 capability built onto the graphics cards. So even though the R9 Nano was a fantastic design to a GPU, and now that it's a lower price point, it's even better, allows you to build some of those really, really small form factors that we showed you in that video and story combination. But you didn't have HDMI 2.0, so it was hard to make the case of it being a home theater PC machine.
Yeah.
Because you want to promote, like, hey, 4K TVs, HDMI 2.0, 4K 60 hertz, blah, blah, blah. And TVs don't have DisplayPort connections. So this adapter, how much was this, Ken?
$30? $37, I think.
$37.99? Exactly. Exactly. And it lets you convert from just DP 1.2 to HDMI 2.0, which you could do on NVIDIA cards, right? Or AMD cards, but it's really only particularly necessary.
That's not true.
No?
If you have a 780 Ti and you'd like to hook it up to your 4K TV, there you go.
That's true. So if you have an older, like a non-Maxwell-based GPU.
Non-Maxwell 2. So if you have a 750 Ti, it would also... If you manage to have one with the DisplayPort, which there weren't very many, but...
Yeah, probably not. But so any older GPU that you want to move over to an HDMI 2.0 connection, 4K 60, or you have, you know, any AMD GPU essentially that exists that has DisplayPort 1.2, you can now convert to 4K 60. It works. It's doing it at 444. It's none of the kind of 420 trickery type stuff, you know, color dithering that we saw on some of the older NVIDIA GPUs through their HDMI 1.4 stuff. So that's on it's $37.99. I think it's only really for sale on Accell's website. That's Accell.com. But if you go find our story, we have a link to that purchase location as well. Up next, the Cerberus. Yeah, I don't know why I kept seeing Cerberus.
It is Cerberus.
Yeah.
Cerebo.
Meet Cerberus. Cerberus.
What? That's spelled differently.
Cerberus.
Cerberus.
Is the dog. The birds three-headed dog, hell. Right?
Three heads. Okay. Yep. It's not the first crowdfunded case, but this is not a mini, like, nano ITX type thing. This is a micro-ATX case made here in the USA, according to this. Jeremy, what sticks out to you about this chassis?
It's freaking tiny.
Yeah.
It's 18.2 liters, which they point out is about 10 liters smaller than anything else on the market. Or to put in more normal terms, it is 320 mils high, 170 millimeters wide, and 364 millimeters deep, aka 12.6 by 6.7 by 14 inches. So, freaking tiny. At the same time, they've set it up in such a way where you've got that nice little swing-out door for if you want to put a water cooler in there, because good luck fitting it anywhere else. It will fit two GPUs, as you can see.
Yep.
It'll do full-sized ATX and as well as the SFX PSUs, which can be a really big thing because SFX PSUs are not cheap and not necessarily easy to find in the power you want.
Right.
It comes in both this black color and a white color. couple of options on it. We can get one with a handle if you so desire. Oh, yeah. But it just, it's a nice looking small case, going to have decent ventilation if you're going to stick a nano in there. And, I mean, you don't usually see things being built by a committee working out well, but I think this may actually do it.
What do we say? Let's see. Indiegogo campaign launches March 1st. Did they mention the expected price tag for something like this? I don't see that on here anywhere.
I need that.
The price or the case?
The case. Look at that.
That's about as compact as you can get. You know, what do you think the airflow is like inside that?
Yeah, probably fine.
You've got to have those blower style coolers on those GPUs, don't you?
Yeah.
Notice they have an Intel 750 SSD between them as well.
They do.
Good thing it has a good heatsink on it.
Like MATX, that's awesome.
Yeah.
It can be that small. Probably not going to be the most pleasant thing to build in. But
oh no, you're going to get cuts on your hand trying to get
once you
in
get
there,
it all in there.
So the door here for the cooler is a nice addition.
I think absolutely. It's mandatory.
Probably yeah. But I mean, like you got to like those cables are going to get smashed down in there, the tubes for the water cooling and that kind of stuff. I don't know. I want to see what the pricing's going to be. I will say that. I actually really liked the in-case M1, which Sebastian references here, as like
a crowdfunded
case. No, I think it was smaller, wasn't it? The in-case M1 was a mini.
I thought it was a little bit bigger than this one.
Was it an ITX case?
Yeah, it was ITX.
Oh, okay.
I think it was an ITX build. But it was a crowdfunded case, but it was also fairly expensive because of its small, runs in production. But I think we'll give this a shot. Hopefully they'll send one our way.
We could fit that in our Pelican case and just like be on the go and have a desktop PC for streaming. Just like,
right.
Have a UPS over the other shoulder.
There you go. Perfect.
Boombox. Real quick, we'll mention this. Qualcomm announces the X16 modem featuring Gigabit LTE because everybody wants that. It's the industry's first gigabit LTE chipset to be announced, achieving speeds of up to 1 gigabit per second using 4X carrier aggregation, succeeding the X12 modem that had 3X carrier aggregation. Out with that old garbage, in with the new hotness, so that we can all get gigabit speeds on our Verizon, AT&T, T-Mobile servers. Right, guys? Right?
Nobody? In 7 years?
Yeah, that's kind of the problem, right? So,
or if you go over to Europe, you can get it now.
Yeah,
pretty much.
Carrier aggregation is such an interesting idea until you understand that like everybody has caps, like everybody's paying per gigabyte in the US. There's unlicensed LTE spectrum that you get into that gets into some of this performance capability.
Almost all of it's leveraging that unlicensed to some extent,
right?
At least in the diagrams that they're showing, which. Well, I mean, if it's around, that's a good thing, but it's not necessarily going to be there.
That's the key is like you could see like on Microsoft's campus, they may integrate LTEU, or Qualcomm's campus, they may maybe on college campuses, they might integrate LTEU to help improve wireless performance across their networks. But it's like, in the middle of Florence, Kentucky, are you going to have this availability of bandwidth? Probably not, at least not in the interim. Right, or in the next foreseeable future. But it's important to have modems like this that come out, that exist, that allow and enable that performance. Even if it's in very selected markets, on selected devices, and selected scenarios. But getting it out there so that we're moving forward on all avenues here. 256.
But it gives you reason to pick up that gigabit router.
That's pretty insane.
The 256 QAM. I think you guys were looking
on a cell phone modem.
You guys were looking up like
QAM 4096.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Oh, that's right. Yeah. Yeah.
It's still 256 on.
Receives data on 4 antennas through 4x4 MIMO and supports up to 4X carrier aggregation. That's
pretty awesome that just works. Like that they like as an engineering thing that they can do that.
So let's get into this topic real quick. We need to talk about it. We don't have to talk about it for that long, but it's a big to do. Jeremy, you're on the wrong story. We're talking about Apple now. You posted the wrong thing.
No, we're talking about Apple. I thought we just skipped that.
No, I thought so too, but Ken just had it in a different order on this on the sidebar than it was in the show notes. It's fine. So Apple posted an open letter to the world about encryption, and Scott wrote up a small editorial about kind of what the topics were, what the reasoning behind it was, his kind of opinions on it. It's an interesting thing. I'm sure everybody's heard the story. The short version of it is the San Bernardino terrorists had iPhones. They're encrypted and locked with their standard 4-to-6-digit PIN. The FBI has requested in a through legal means for Apple to build an operating system that would allow them to brute force unlock the phone, allow the FBI to do it, like in order to just, if it's only a 4-digit password, you've got 10,000 combinations.
Yep.
You know, so you could do it. The problem is, as the phone is today, after 10, it like erases the whole drive, right? The whole device, right? So they don't want to do that. They want Apple to enable it to be brute force without that hanging over their head. Apple does not want to do that. They call it creating a backdoor, a slippery slope down, other things that they might do. This line closes their letter. It says, "We believe the FBI's intentions are good. It would be wrong for the government to force us to build a backdoor into our products, and ultimately we fear that this demand would undermine the very freedoms and liberty our government is meant to protect." This is a really politically charged debate. We were just listening to like the Marco Rubio town hall before we started getting ready for the show, and this was like the thing that came up in that discussion.
Security versus freedom. What do you want?
And it's
freedom.
Wait, what?
Yeah, you can only pick one.
Yeah.
How?
You can only pick one.
Security versus it's a privacy argument. It's not a freedom argument.
Oh, it's freedom.
It's freedom.
It's the freedom to be private.
This is America. We're always free.
It's the freedom to be private is what it is, right? It's the freedom to have encrypted stuff.
Free my privates.
Right. My guess is in China, they don't have that freedom.
No.
No.
Right. No. I would guess that would be the case. So, everybody's going to have their opinion on this, but I'm curious, like, the three of us have discussed this internally.
Mm-hmm.
Josh, Jeremy, what side do you fall on this? Are you... And you don't have to have like a blanket answer. I support Apple. I support the FBI. But what's your stance?
You know, I'm surprised that Apple took this stance a little bit, and I applaud them for that, because every choice we make, there is risk involved, and I'd like to think that we as people who live in the United States and any kind of human out there believes in the individual, mm-hmm. and the ability to do what we want without hurting others. So I want to encrypt my stuff, and it's not hurting any others. Why do I have to be punished? I mean, what if I'm saying, nasty things to Ken, and he's saying nasty things back, and we don't want that conversation public, but it's not hurting anybody, because mm-hmm. Ken is really gross in the things that he talks about.
that's normal.
Yeah, and so it's... Why do we have to have these back doors? We have to have the government sneaking in when they don't need to. I mean, it's my life. It's my privacy.
Yeah.
I may not do things the way you like it, but it's not hurting you. So what's the point? It's good to have this. And, it's been a big debate. Like I said earlier, I mean, do you want to have a lot of security? And if by having a lot of security means you've got cameras everywhere, you've got people poking into your stuff, you have people, government agencies checking out your kids, it just where does it stop? And I'm happy that Apple said, the line is drawn here, no further.
Yeah. Jeremy, what do you think?
Weaponizing math has got to be one of the most absurd things I have encountered in many absurd things over the past decade or so. But that's sort of what this comes down to is, well, you can't use encryption and math that we can't just immediately figure out. That's just horrible. And apart from the absurdity of it, the thing is that, I'm not calling them technological illiterates, but they're bloody technological illiterates. If you put a backdoor in something, it doesn't just magically open for one person. Once the backdoor is there, it's there for frickin' everyone to find and exploit. So as soon as you put that in, anyone and their brother is going to be finding a way to get in there, and boom, that's it. Now, all the people you don't want in there are in there. It's not just going to be the magic government fairies that get in there. You put that back door in, everyone's going to get in sooner or later.
I hate government.
There is some differences here with this particular thing, though.
There is, because this wouldn't be an OS-wide thing. This would be a very specific thing.
Well, no, right. it's that all that this does, it's bypassing like the fact that it waits longer and longer on bad passwords or bad passcodes, yeah. And the fact that it's, if in this case, I think the phone has the thing turned on where if you do 10 bad attempts, then it just wipes itself. It. Right. Yeah. So they're trying to just get around that part so that they can then brute force the passcode. But, right. You know,
and it's not like the FBI. Well, it's not like the FBI has a court order for them to put this in every iPhone. It is to flash an updated version of the software onto this specific iPhone.
Yeah.
It's not necessarily creating a backdoor in every iPhone tomorrow.
It's interesting to me.
Although I have very big worries about once they create the version of this operating system, right. What happens to it.
Yeah.
That's a fair worry to have. Like, this is interesting to me in that, first of all, did the government know what they were asking was even possible? Like, did Apple have to go, yeah, we could do that if we wanted to, and then they got the court order? Well, I was just curious about that.
Didn't we find out that it's actually not possible on, like, the newer iPhones?
I don't think it's possible on anything with a Touch ID sensor.
Oh, okay.
Because of the way the encryption's handled.
This is much less of an issue for me than if it's not even possible on the more modern phones and all the future ones going out.
Right.
Right. So...
Yeah, until they want it on all new phones coming out.
That's the
just
concern.
In case
that's,
this happens.
And that's again. The concern.
That's because possible that the government might somehow mandate what the product has to allow.
It's precedent, right? Like, if the court is able to get... leverage Apple to do X, mm-hmm. then in the future...
But what if Apple says we actually can't do that anymore?
Well...
Right.
Yeah, but if they did it on a previous one, mm-hmm. then the argument can be made, well, so you should have kept making them that way.
Well,
so
then, yeah, but we so didn't. Then like, they've be, already stopped
right, right,
doing
right.
it that
but
way.
Then there could be some future law that says, well, any U.S. manufacturer has to
you
include
know, and there
this
may not
possibility.
Even be a future law that we know of public. There could be some right. real kind of pressurings, like you get a visit from the Treasury Department and IRS
yeah.
to Apple. It says
I think they deserve that anyway, regardless of what they're getting out of this. To me, I see some interesting comments in the chat about this. It's like I view this as I think there's a safer way to do this than the way it's being presented. The way it's being presented now is like, hey, you give us the tool to enable that, right? And yeah. I would rather see Apple make this change to this one device and then give the phone to the FBI, as opposed to giving the FBI the tool to do this in other devices in the future, right? And then your trust factor has to go back from... the government back to Apple. Now, you may have different opinion on which one of those things you trust more or less than the other,
yeah.
right? But like I said before, when we were having this comment before, even though Apple hasn't created this thing yet, the fact that they say that they can, like your inherent trust in them should remain the same, whether or not they have done the thing that they can do or not.
If they do it at all, I would prefer that they don't just give the FBI this method of doing this.
Right.
You know... Fine. Pass
okay,
us the
but
phone.
That phone is going to be in evidence. So let's say Apple takes that and they, desolder all the memory, put it on another board that has the updated firmware and whatnot that they can get past that stuff.
Sure.
That phone goes back in evidence.
Is that even admissible anymore? Like chain of
you just need chain of custody. So you would just have people at Apple sign for receiving it and stuff. It's still you still have
yeah
chain
no
of
I'm
custody.
Talking about that evidence is going back to the feds,
mm-hmm.
and well, they've yeah. got the technology in hand and the software that they can deconstruct.
One of the things we were talking about.
We had that debate before. Would they be able to like
because you can't yeah
diff
like,
the OS and
like an iPhone's not going to take any update any OS. update that's not signed by Apple. Like, and that's already coded in there. And the catch-22 is you can't really change the OS in order to make it accepted then it's not without signed. It being signed.
Well,
yeah. Like,
I mean,
no, it's not that.
Change
it's,
the...
it's like there's a check going on at a very low level for like signed code for it to update itself.
Yeah, right? but jailbreaking is a thing. And if they found the change, they need to make the operating system. In theory, there could be a jailbreak like exploit that the FBI could use to make these changes on the operating system so they could brute force another phone.
There could be.
It's interesting to look at the technology.
It's very interesting. I also find it more like. Now knowing that this is a 5C and this is not possible on a 6 or a 6S. Well,
maybe not possible.
Maybe not possible or a 6 on a 6S. Right. To me, it's even less of a... like I have been on the side of, look, this is a one-time thing.
Yeah.
As long as we follow the legality of getting a warrant to do this and not just giving the federal government the ability to blanket access these devices.
Yeah.
I'm probably okay with it, with some caveats. The fact that it's like, I'm not saying that people who have older phones don't deserve the same rights as everybody else, but it's like, oh, well, this solution might kind of solve itself as we progress through phone sales. Like, okay, maybe that helps. And also, I think that, I know it's everybody considers it a backdoor still. I find it less of a backdoor if you have physical access to the device. I know that's kind of a... odd way of putting it, but it's not like they're building in a thing in the operating system where the federal government can do this while my phone is sitting here, right?
And my other question is, if you've got actual physical access to that phone, can you not desolder the body chip?
It's still
make
encrypted.
An exact copy of it and then screw the fuck around with that.
No, there's a part that's not accessible externally.
Now you can try and unencrypt it without having to worry about that 10, or if it does. Well, you make another copy.
Okay, so that level of encryption is actually the actual like file system level encryption.
Okay, so you can't even read it at that point.
Well, no, it's not that. Like brute forcing that, you're trying to brute force like AES 256.
Right.
Good for freaking lot.
Which, if anyone could,
so you go from just trying to brute force the passcode in a reasonable amount of time to brute forcing like, you know, more combinations than there are like atoms on the earth or some crap.
Right.
Like that.
Think about a 4-digit passcode has 10,000 combinations. They would much rather have the option to do that than 256-bit AES.
Yeah.
it's an interesting precedent for the federal government to compel a private company to develop, to use their time and resources to develop something that they don't want to develop.
Right.
Correct. I do agree with that. That
it's
like
not exactly free market.
Compelling
there.
That's the other thing.
Company to do something.
Like, so think about that. In terms of like how expensive is Apple's time as a company, right?
Do you want them to roll out an OS? I think if you're looking for the sympathy nod towards Apple's use of time and finances,
not Apple specifically, but like, okay, what if it's a mom and pop company?
I get it, but
like,
it's not.
You could put that company out of business.
I get it, but it's not. Like, this is the largest company in the world.
But there's no, but. You know, the precedent doesn't work that way. It's like, you got a company to do this. Mm-hmm. There's no little note that says, oh, but if it's a mom and pop shop.
It's a judge's
decision.
But
this only applies if you make several billion dollars a year. If you make less than that, then you're immune
to it.
Saying,
no, the law doesn't work that way. This is a judge's decision.
But if it happens this time, if you're in the same situation, but the device is just made by somebody lesser.
Let's say I made my own fork of Android and put this in there. You don't think they would compel me to do the same thing?
The precedent would already be there. There would be no reason a judge wouldn't say, yeah, and order Ken to do that.
Well,
that
and case. Then if you're a small guy, you say, look, that's going to cost me $100,000
development
time. The federal government would say, well, we'll pay you to do that.
No, they go, we will put you in jail if you do not do it.
Well, they might do that.
See, that's where I'm kind of going with this. Like,
I think that's a dumb part of the argument. Not that it's a dumb part, but it's like it's irrelevant in this instance because you're not going to get somebody that goes, oh, boo-hoo, Apple had to spend 5 engineers 10 days to do this, right?
Like, I think it's more than that.
Like, it's an interesting thought of what the precedent and where you draw the line after that of what do you compel them to develop for you.
Yeah, it is. Yeah. And that's why at the beginning of our discussion earlier today, I was like, just make it so you can't do it anymore.
You know, it'd be so funny. They go through all this.
Like,
and
if
just,
you
like,
actually can't do it.
Then. Just like when people are saying in chat, they go through all this and it's like, it's actually 1, 2, 3, 4.
Like, I bet they tried a couple. I bet they've tried like all 4 zeros and like
you think
1, 2, 3, 4.
You think
they're
like,
well,
just
like,
all right, we're out. Don't do any more. We're gonna burn it.
Apparently, there's talk that it can work on the like the same sort of thing can work on the 6 and 6S, but like the operating system they developed to work on the 5C would not work with secure enclave phones, but it's still possible to develop a similar sort of.
I'm sure there are ways that they could. Well, if that got out
and was analyzed, or even if it was that those changes were just analyzed by the FBI, like that's just chinks in the armor of
Apple's thing, right?
I get it. You know, you're giving away part of the keys to the kingdom when you do something like that.
I get it. It's an interesting thought experiment, at least.
I see the value
in getting the data off the phone, right?
Yeah.
The potential value, because you don't know what's on it. There could be nothing on it, or there could be everything on it, right? The potential value of what's on the phone is, to me, worth having the thought experiment and maybe worth having a trial at it. I don't know.
I can't see it being the one simple solution that solves all of the questions that are open in this. It's not the only thing. There is more evidence. There will be more communications. There are other ways.
I guess I see. You know, like you had the Google CEO come out in support of Tim Cook and who else came out and did that today? Somebody else did.
I only saw Sundar.
Microsoft did.
No.
Google CEO came out and said that not Alphabet CEO, Google CEO. Just to be sure,
that's just their stock.
said that we support them, and that makes sense for them because they run Android. They don't want to be put in the same predicament.
Yeah, I mean, Android 6.0 forces full disk encryption. Yeah,
it is the same thing, right?
Which Apple's been doing for a couple of years. Yep. But Android 6.0 does it now. So like,
it would be interesting.
This will not be the end.
No. I think this is something we'll hear about for a while, and if they continue to fight it. It'll be interesting to see if it makes it to the Supreme Court and what their decisions are. I don't know. It'll be interesting. I think, Ken, I'm going to screw this up here, and I'm going to go to the ad first before we move on to the next story. I'm not going to move that at all. No, I would just leave the rundown where it is. I would do to mention real quick that this episode of the PC Perspective Podcast is brought to you by Braintree Payments. By next year, maybe even next week, there could be a whole new way to pay.
Could be.
Maybe the federal government knows about it. Already, and they're just waiting to tell us. Maybe it will be the next Bitcoin, or could be the next Apple Pay, or a combination of the two, Bit Apple Coin. You know, think about it. Fortunately, Braintree's full stack payment platform is easily adaptable to whatever the future holds, so you can adapt to it easily too. Accept everything from pounds to PayPal to that next big innovation from any device with just one integration. And when that new payment method comes out, all you have to do is update a few lines of code. That sounds much better than the alternative. No late nights, no complicated recoding, no stress about staying ahead of the curve. Braintree Payments is here to help. Learn more at braintreepayments.com/PCPer. They have simple, secure payments, code you can integrate quickly. If you don't have time, you can give them a call and they'll handle the integration for you. It supports Android, iOS, JavaScript clients. They have SDKs for .NET, Node.js, Java, Perl, PHP, Python, and Ruby. That's a lot of them, and it's elegant code written with clear documentation. So again, visit them and learn about it at braintreepayments.com/PCPer, and we thank them for their support of this very podcast you listen to. All right,
soon they may even take Canadian.
What? Nobody wants that.
That's like monopoly money.
Have you seen that graph? I watch it every day. You Canadians are getting a raise from me every week.
It was so true. it was so bad that we were looking at buying an expensive camera and we priced out what it would cost in Canada and have you ship it to us. And it was That's true. It was a little bit lower.
Yeah, but then I was worried about returns and all that stuff too. Alan, let's talk real quick about Micron's upcoming 3D NAND, what it means for capacities, performances, costs.
Yeah.
What does it mean?
What does it mean?
So Micron had a kind of sort of press release-ish kind of thing. It was going to be a press release, and then they said, well, no, but you can talk about it on this day. Anyway.
Yep.
So they gave us some information about their upcoming, their 3D NAND. So this is basically what's going to be the IMFT-style Intel/Micron fab 3D NAND. And it's going to be 32-layer, and the extra info we have is now, like, page sizes, block sizes, things like that, and those kinds of things play into when you try to guesstimate how well a SSD is going to perform, like 4K random write performance or something like that, right? So in this case, this memory has 16 kilobyte pages, which is pretty large for a page, and the block size is either 16 meg for MLC or 24 meg for TLC. So like, so this is like your kind of worst case thing if you had an SSD with very little over provisioning and you were doing like 4K random to it continuously to like the whole span of the thing. So think like an enterprise kind of scenario. Eventually the thing would get to the point where more times than not, a 4K write would translate to a 16 or a 24 megabyte write on that SSD. So that's kind of a big amplification effect. That's actually part of the reason that like the Intel Enterprise PCIe SSDs, right, like the P3600, 3700, stuff like that, or especially like the 3608, that one that was a dual drive, right? They all three kind of had the same amount of flash on them, but the capacities got much, much lower. Like, they had the same amount of flash dies. So the performance was actually higher. The performance was higher in the smaller capacity models.
Which is abnormal.
Well, kind of abnormal, right? But the performance was much higher because they basically had the same amount of flash, but they were over-provisioning it so far that if you had larger blocks, well, those blocks don't seem as large now if you're only using, like, a fraction of them, right? So basically, like, that kind of trick makes it so you can do random, you know, really hit the SSD hard on random writes and still keep performance high, right? Because you're not playing musical chairs with as much of the data to do each one of those writes. So that was good information that came out, but I think the much more important tidbit, aside from all that same die size stuff that we just talked about on Samsung, applies to this too, right? You're going to make small SSDs. You kind of shoot yourself in the foot if you have a 32 gigabyte die, right?
Gigabyte. Really?
16 or 32 gigabytes in die capacity is where we're getting.
Okay.
Like per die. It's the case where 120 gig SSD is like four dies, right? So that same kind of stuff is going to apply to. And we're not even sure what the speed of their 3D NAND is going to be. Like, we know Samsung's ended up being much quicker. We don't know if IMFT stuff is going to be twice as fast as their planar stuff. We have no way of knowing that until it actually comes out, right?
But twice as fast, does the WoC only last half as long?
Actually, the endurance for this stuff... It's a nice segue though, kind of. It's actually a segue. They're claiming endurance of 30,000 cycles, 30,000 write cycles, which is really freaking high.
It's high
of a number.
Okay.
Yeah. I mean, like, their planar stuff was like 1,500 or 3,000 for like the most recent generation stuff.
Oh.
Yeah. Okay. So. When Samsung came out with their VNAND, they said they were claiming twice the endurance. This is 10 times. Right? So that is pretty good.
Right.
And the kind of reason for that difference is that they're still using floating gate for their design, right? They basically adopted their technical ability that they were using on planar NAND, which is what almost everybody was using on planar NAND. But Intel and Micron are the ones that figured out how to make that same technology work in 3D, which supposedly gives them more volume of a channel to store electrons compared to the other technology, like the stuff that's in VNAND. So that's good. And it's also very good at like controlling leakage of electrons. So that's what also helps you with your endurance, right? That most important tidbit that was kind of snuck in there, and I can't say how they're going to do it, but I think their next step is going to be to double the capacity per die. So they're not going to do like what Samsung did, which they went from 32 layers to like 48 layers. The next generation of this stuff, after the one that hasn't come out yet, but the next generation is going to have double the capacity. Because they've already talked about, like, presented stuff to, I forget what the name of the, whatever ISSCC is called. There's actually a presentation from Micron at ISSCC that already happened, where they talked about die capacities of 512 gigabit and 768 gigabit for TLC. So that's like...
Is that 64 layers?
Can't say.
What do you mean you can't say? It they says could, right here, could, you can do the could, math for that on your own.
Well, they can make the dies bigger.
Yeah.
Okay. See, there's other ways to do it, right? So we can't say yet how they're going
to
do it.
How many layers tall does it have to be before I can see the thickness? It's like, I want to see it.
You want to be able to tell?
I want it to be like this. I want it to be like a stack of quarters. 10,000 layers.
Like, I don't think the thickness is really that far off between, like, a CPU die thickness and, like, this 32-layer stuff. Because, really?
Because
if you think CPU dies, like, there's a lot of, like, interconnects going on, like, a bunch of layers of that, which actually is part of this as well. Like, they're saying 75% of their, like, interconnect and, like, CMOS logic and stuff, the stuff that's dealing with the switching and, like, the moving data around, that stuff is a layer on its own as opposed to being off to the side. In this type of flash specifically, which is also a new thing, right? Usually if you look at a flash memory die, there's like a little chunk off to the side that looks like a different, you know, you just have the flash area, which is all just like, you know, just like a, doesn't have any kind of structure to it at all. And just looks like a flat plane of just stuff, right? Because it's just a grid of tightly packed flash cells, right? But then off to the side, there'll be like this section of logic. So the idea is they're moving some of that underneath. Which is good, because now you don't need that thing off to the side to be as large anymore. Now the dies are smaller for the same capacity, right? Now you got more dies
so
on a wafer.
So it's not the size of the die, it's how you work the interconnect.
Kind of, yeah. But I would imagine that Intel kind of provided some of the thinking behind that, because that's exactly how like the interconnects on CPUs work, to be able to connect all those, you know.
They have some pretty good production people in that regard.
Yeah, yeah. I'd say they're kind of, you know.
Did they give us a timeline on all this?
In the know. So
that means no.
The current generation stuff, it should be sampling to people. It's just not in any shipping product yet.
Yeah.
But it should definitely be at the like sampling and like, you know, that kind of thing. We saw it in one SSD like prototype at CES. Like it just had those chips on it. But
right.
You know, nothing that's in a shipping product yet. So
fair enough.
You should have stole it.
Yeah, just grab it. Just run.
Our last news story of the day is apparently NVIDIA is working on, according to this rumor at least, a new iteration of the GTX 950, but not the 950 Ti. This would instead kind of go the other direction. The 950 LP is what it's kind of being called right now. Yep, low power, so it's still Maxwell 2.0.
Is this a desktop thing?
Yes, it would be a desktop add-in card, GM206 based, a little bit lower performing than the GTX 950, if the specs are right. You've got 768 CUDA cores on the 950, 640 on the new 950 LP, fewer texture units, half the raster ROPs, half the ROPs, about the same GPU clock, 128-bit memory bus, 2 gigs of memory, and about the same memory frequency and
but
all that.
Isn't the 950, the non-LP, like still pretty power efficient?
It is. It is. This
you
is
still
just
need a 6-pin power cable for it.
Yep.
Yeah. Uh-huh. So the estimate here is this is a 70-watt part instead of a 90-watt part.
Oh, you can power that off the bus.
I would.
75
it
watts.
Would be, it would be right on the edge. Yeah. It would be right on.
It
the
is
edge.
Right on the edge, but yeah. Like.
Well, 75 watts is the spec for a PCIe slot.
Yeah.
Yeah.
PCIe.
So I don't know if this is, you know, Sebastian and I were talking about this rumor this morning, and it seems likely that this might be like an OEM only part.
I would imagine.
Right, I don't know, man. With all the other, there's so much GPU crap like it floating up in the air right now. I don't see this being a beneficial retail product necessarily, unless it's supplanting something. Like if you look at this diagram that Video Cards put together, it's got the 950 and then the 750 Ti, the 950 LP, and then the 750, and it kind of gives you an idea of what the breakdown is and you know that type of stuff. The 750 Ti still has lower power consumption than this supposed 950 LP. Same number of shaders, similar clock speeds and memory configurations and all that. But I would think the 950 LP would be faster than the 750 Ti.
So is this just like maybe a yield thing?
I mean, at this point in a product's life, yes. Everything
like,
is a yield.
Hey, we got a stack of chips that had you know, a quarter of the ROPs bad.
Yep. You know,
like,
it's exactly what it would be. It's like, man, we got all this silicon sitting here in this bin.
Yeah.
It's just like in this just in this drawer, and every time they open it up, it's jingle, jingle, jingle. All just, the GPU dies.
Tom's got that filing cabinet drawer on his desk. Like, he just opens it up.
There's 7,500 of these GPUs here. I wish we could make a product to sell them.
I mean, like, the 750 Ti is what, like 2 years old at this
February 18th, 2014.
Yeah, so date. I don't know.
Ooh, tomorrow's its birthday.
Put a new product out. I don't know.
So
I'm going to get a cake.
So in high school or like junior high, like one of my teachers had like this drawer, his like filing cabinet drawer. There's a filing cabinet drawer on both sides of his desk, right?
Yeah.
And he only ever used the left one. And like on the last day of school, I happened to be like the last guy walking out of the room. And he's like, hey, come over here. And he like opens up the other side drawer and it's literally full to the top of like fireballs and like all the candy he'd confiscated from all the students. And he's just like, here you go, just take as much as you can. And I just shoveled the whole thing into my bag and went home for the summer and just proceeded to break all my teeth and get a bunch of cavities. Yeah, it was just such a crazy sight just to open up the drawer.
You know, I was kind of scared about that story about what you find those drawers at first, but I'm happy.
All candy. Just like,
it was all candy.
All the compensated candy. All
the way down. And you want some candy?
It was all the way down.
Said the physics teacher.
Now, somebody said in the chat that you could buy the card on their store. I don't know if I don't.
The LP?
No, I think they're talking about, you can only buy the Titan X or the 980 Ti online anyway, from NVIDIA directly, I guess I should say.
Yeah.
So anyway, that's a rumor going around. I don't really know what to think of it or if I care enough to continue looking at it, but I guess the answer is I don't. So let's get into our hardware software picks of the week. This is interesting. I'm going to bring this up, even though I don't recommend you buy it at this location. So we have here at the office, how many lights did we decide, Ken, that needed to be replaced?
16.
It was like 13. No.
13, 16, I think.
16. So we have 16 of those overhead fluorescent lights that each hold four tubes.
Four bulbs each, yeah.
Yeah. And they're all old. You know, we haven't really replaced any since we've moved into this place.
They
and,
get
you know,
progressively lower like, on the color temperature.
Yeah, as they age.
Just turn yellow.
You know, like every fourth one is out now.
I'm getting a suntan from these
right.
lights.
Yeah.
So I happened to be going through the Costco yesterday, the day before, and I saw these. Fight, as I believe it's pronounced, Electric, who makes light bulbs and a bunch of other stuff, sells these LED versions of those 4 foot T8 tubes that are actually just drop in replacements. You don't have to remove any of the old hardware, cut out any wires. You just drop it in. Now, Amazon has these for $45.99 for two, one pack, which is two. Costco had them for like $25.
Uh-huh.
For the two packs. So obviously don't buy them through Amazon. Go find out where you can find them. You know, and then Ken and I have been looking on like Alibaba and trying to find like
you can buy 30 packs for about $5 a piece.
Yeah, you can buy 30 packs for like $6 a piece. But most of them, they all require you to
remove the ballast, which is probably a good idea anyways, because you're going to save power consumption by removing the ballast.
That's true,
I guess, but
and it's completely unnecessary right now.
Like cutting
wires, actually remove it, you
things.
Just bypass it. Like you don't have to pull it out of the housing or anything.
No, but they're cutting the wire and then you have to disconnect it from the line.
You're just connecting the bulb to like the main instead of to the ballast,
right?
The high
you're
voltage.
Connecting the 12 volt. Or wait,
120.
Sorry,
this is not a power supply.
Directly to it. And some of those ones we found on Alibaba even have that, like it said, they were Cree LEDs.
Yeah,
and which then, now they're not. You never know.
No, they're probably made by Cree, like the actual.
But
parts.
They might be like the C parts or something.
Sure,
right. So I bought two of these and I put them on the lights. And it's funny because we have the two LED ones.
And you didn't have to remove the starter. Like you just there is no starter on these ballasts actually.
There's not.
It's electronic, right? There's not a little.
I don't
little
know
can
the answer to that.
That screws in.
I don't know.
Yeah, like,
would it be a replaceable item?
Yeah.
Like, it'd have to be replaced type of thing?
Eventually.
Yeah, I didn't see those when I looked at them.
Yeah. So they just run off the ballast voltage.
We put on two of these new LED white ones and the two old ones, and you look at this light,
difference.
There's like 1,000K color temperature difference.
There is.
Just like side by side in light. It's actually pretty funny. So I'm debating how I want to replace all these with a mono, like, I want to have one color light bulbs.
Tanya, Chinese man. We
yeah,
can't go wrong.
I don't know.
We know where these are being sourced from anyways. Let's just go directly to the source.
But they're not the same because these you don't have to replace the ballast and everything. And all the ones we found online so far require you to do that. But That's what I
get. You know, I finally upgraded to LED lighting in my house. Ace had a special 460-watt bulbs for $10 a pack.
Not bad.
Pretty good.
Yeah.
Yeah. And so I, yeah, you know, good. I bought a couple of packs and screwed those things in. And I was like,
Which ones were they?
Not bad.
Like, were they Cree or something? Or
I have no idea.
Probably not Cree. Probably like a knockoff brand.
Yeah.
Yeah, probably. But it's still.
I've kind of been doing that as I go. I can't bring myself to replace all of the bulbs because it would be like a $350 light bulb bill or something like that. Because I have a lot of the recessed lighting.
Yeah, but $2.50 a light.
Yeah. That's.
But you got to be an A.
I have a lot of the recessed lighting floodlights.
Yeah.
And those are a little bit more expensive.
IKEA makes them. I think they're $5 a piece.
Yeah, I don't know. I've just been looking at Home Depot and stuff. Yeah, you got to put the parts together.
No, it's just a screw-in. No, like,
it was a joke.
Yeah.
But, like, I actually ran into a problem with the floodlights, recessed lights, because the retention mechanism was, like, it wouldn't let the thing I bought at Home Depot fit in.
Yep.
I actually had to buy, like, those ultra-thin Philips ones,
mm-hmm.
right? And those are fine, but they were, like, $7 a piece or something like that instead. Yeah. But
I have three of, like, the $15 GE ones because they have Zigbee radios in them.
Ah, right.
So it's like, that's like, a big bill.
When you look through your whole house and it's like, okay, like, the little chandelier in the dining room has six bulbs in it and they're the small, like, candelabra ones. Those aren't necessarily really cheap.
Those are still $5 a piece.
Yeah, like, everything is the same price. I'm like, wow, I got several hundred dollars worth of light bulbs. I'm just going to do this as they blow out, right, and go down that round. So.
Yeah, because, you know, 20, it's a nice thing.
Yeah, exactly.
Lifespan.
Yeah. Jeremy, what do you got?
The one thing that all point-of-sales software has in common is that they're all POSs. And so people have been playing around with barcode hacks for quite a while now. This recent one is just downright friggin' disturbing. All you need is four custom printed barcodes, which essentially then send Windows key R, command.exe, fires up an FTP program to download and install an exe. You now own the Windows system sitting behind that barcode scanner. Now, a cashier is probably going to cash you, but think of how many bloody self-serve kiosks are sticking around, up to and including lotto machines, where you're just scanning a barcode, and no one's paying attention to what you're doing. And now the next thing you know, you own that lotto machine, and it just sort of delays announcing the winners until you go and pick it up.
Right.
So, I mean, I don't know if any of you guys watching work in retail or anything, but if you can, please turn debug and config mode off on your POS, because that's why this works. And if you turn those off, you're perfectly safe. If you don't, expect some really interesting things to happen, because this is simply scanning four barcodes.
I think I'm going to add that barcode to my key ring on my iPhone.
And I still want to know if it'll work for that, too.
Got your, got your Kroger card? Yeah, sure.
Yep.
Doop. Here, try this one.
Oh, it didn't scan the first time.
Do that to Qdoba.
Yep.
So, yeah, if you're like me and you don't like self-checkout, so you just got a retailer that you
I own your computer to do horrible system. Things to. I want unlimited lifetime burritos immediately.
Awesome. Yeah.
All right, interesting. Jeremy. Or no, sorry, we already talked to you. Josh. How about you, Josh?
I don't have them in here, but, you know, these model price $10 earbuds with the microphone are pretty dang good. I mean, it's nice $9.99. Build quality. What?
Aren't they $9.99?
They are.
They're $9.99. It's got the ribbon cables. They sound okay. It's got the inline mic. They work nice. And, you know, I have no complaints. A friend of mine was really curious about them and some of the other ones, and he ordered up like three different pairs from Monoprice. And these are nice. I mean, they're
shoved in my ear hole right now.
Exactly. I mean, $10. $10.
They're essentially disposable at that point.
Yeah, pretty much.
Yeah.
We should buy a couple of sets of these and keep them around for like when you have guests on the podcast and stuff.
I'm just gonna give them ones full of earwax.
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah.
You just order them. I can ship you these ones down.
You just order them full that, like, from the factory.
Yeah.
Oh, man.
What is reflective sound technology?
I don't know. Stuff bounces around inside there.
Listen, they had to put some marketing material on the page.
Yeah.
Okay.
Versus conventional earphone. It's down in the frequency response comparison graph.
I see.
Right here.
Well, I know this that. One. But.
See how reflective it is? It goes up. It goes up higher?
Sure.
Mm, it's shiny. Not quite electrostatic, but it is reflective.
Mm. Boom. All right, Alan, what's your pick?
My pick is. So I was looking for, like, you know that Samsung T1 came with that really thin little, like, flat ribbon style connector, right? Which is kind of cool.
I do.
I was looking for one for USB Type-C. And I found it, and it's like $10 for three. It's weird, the kind of deals that they're running on this Amazon page. If you want two, it's like $8. If you want three, it's like $9.
Mm-hmm. These all sell.
If you want six, it's like 14.
Mm-hmm.
And they're all like different colors and crap. Mm-hmm. It's kind of interesting.
Are these the ones that set fire to your computer?
I hope not, because I ordered some, and I'll find out. You know, no way to know if it's set fire to your computer until you plug it in.
How big is it? It's this big, apparently. That's a horrible measurement.
11.
No, there's another picture.
10.
Somebody doesn't know how to use a ruler.
You don't start it at 10. Or this is looks like it started at 10 and a half.
It really does.
It went from 10 and a half to 20 and a half. What the hell?
Yeah.
So they got Peter North in there showing how long it is.
Hmm. Towards the bottom, there's a picture of just like an iPhone. Or not iPhone. A...
something.
That's the OnePlus 2.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, Type-C connector.
Yeah. All right. There you go.
You know, looks cool if you're in the need of that sort of a thing.
There's probably not a whole lot of people in the need for Type-C connector yet.
No, but if you need just to like plug it into a power bank, like
we were looking earlier for like Type-C to Type-C, and it was harder to find than you would have thought, huh?
You want to be really careful with that.
Some of them are only rated
for... Well, the Google researcher that was doing all of this testing, his Chromebook just blew up, and he's not testing until he can get a new one.
Yeah, but we're not using these as charging cables for laptops like that. We're using the Kinect and regular USB devices.
Fair enough.
Yeah.
And such.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, the whole Type-C cable thing is kind of a mess right now.
Yeah, it really is.
All right, everybody, that's going to be it for the show this week. Thank you very much for joining us. PCPort.com/podcast. Find all the back episodes or find the ways to subscribe to this one. Don't forget we have our new video subscription and video RSS feeds that you can subscribe to. Shout out to Christopher M. and Douglas B., who pledged to our Patreon during the podcast.
Sweet.
At patreon.com/PCPur. And to Michael M., who upped their pledge from $5 to $5.55.
Sweet.
555.
555. So no, fives is
doesn't,
a good
doesn't work.
It's my favorite kind of timer.
Doesn't work. Well, that's true. It's a lovely timer.
So thank you to those guys. If you want to support us and contribute, we would be eternally grateful. Maybe not eternally. Like, grateful for
at really least for a couple
time.
Of months.
Like, for a really long time. But maybe not. Eternity is a long time.
It's true.
You know, patreon.com/PCPur. We really appreciate that, guys. Help us hit that next milestone if you can. And like I said, sign up for the mailing list. We'll have some cool stuff to do in the next week or two. I'll be at Mobile World Congress next week. I don't know what I'm going to see or what I'm going to do. I've never been to the show. I may get totally lost in the city of Barcelona and just like eat food at random places until it's time to go home. I don't really know.
If
I see bulls, run the other way.
Yeah, do some rubber bands around your wallet and put it in your front pocket.
So it's not bulls aren't like bears. You don't run up to them like with your arms up in the air and go, ah, rah, 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 rah.
No?
No, don't do that? Okay.
How well does that work with bears?
Pretty good, I heard.
How's your life insurance and who's it made out to?
I mean, it's...
You signed those papers it gave you, right?
Yeah, I didn't even look at them. It's fine.
Great. Yeah.
Yeah, that's great. All right, guys, we'll see you next week. I'm Ryan Schraub.
I'm Jeremy Hellstrom.
I'm Josh Walrath.
And I'm Alan Malentano.
Bye.